Another American female sculptor was Vinnie Ream Hoxie. Ream is her maiden name, Hoxie is her married name, as we'll see. Vinnie Ream Hoxie has a number of, I should say Vinnie Ream at this point, has a number of firsts. She is the first woman, and she is the youngest person to receive a sculpture commission from the U.S. government. Okay, how did that happen? Well, first let's talk about who she is, where she comes from. She's from out west, Wisconsin. Remember, at this time, that would be pretty far out west. She's born in what is Madison, Wisconsin, when it's still pretty much a frontier. Her father was a land surveyor, a territorial official. I found one reference that said that they were their house was served as kind of the inn on the stagecoach stop. They didn't have rooms, just the passengers would sleep on the floor. They moved around a bit. I think they moved to Missouri, they moved to Washington, you know, they moved back different places. And when they were in Missouri, she went to a Christian girls' school. It was called Christian College at Columbia, Missouri. It's now Columbia College, where she studied art, literature, and music. And I did find a reference on the website that the college still owns a painting that she did of Martha Washington, but I didn't find the reproduction. In 1861, the start of the Civil War, the family moves to Washington, D.C. Her father is a civil servant. He's working for the government. And Vinnie also gets a job with the U.S. government. She works as a postal clerk in the dead letter office. She is one of the first women who's employed by the U.S. government. I don't know if they thought working in the dead letter office would be okay because she wouldn't be out in public or something, but that's where she's working. She, of course, participated as a young lady might in the war effort by, going to the soldiers' that they would have in Washington. Of course, they would have the hospitals for the soldiers, and she would write letters for them that they could send to their loved ones. She was evidently a very good singer. She was in the church choir. She would go to the hospitals and sing as entertainment for the troops. She'd also sing in the churches, and some of these were benefits to raise money for the injured troops. She was photographed, and as you can see, she's a very, very pretty young lady. Detail from the photograph. How did she get her start as a sculptor? Well, she visited the sculptor, Clark Mills, who was a very well-known sculptor in America at the time. He created America's first equestrian statue, which we see here is Andrew Jackson, rearing horse. And so the reason she was going to the studio, as I understand, I just found a little reference on the website, was that there was a commission for her college. And the U.S. senator was involved, or the congressman, I'm not sure which, and because she was there locally in Washington, she went with him. When she saw the work, it was like, oh my goodness, maybe I can do this. And so she decided to model a head in clay, and she shows it to Mills. She takes it for critique, and he's very impressed and takes her on as a student. There's no mention of whether her art training in college included sculpture, art modeling with clay at all. I don't know that. Maybe someone else could find out. Okay, what became her breakthrough piece was when, in 1866, she won a commission, a $10,000 commission, to create the statue of Abraham Lincoln for the Capitol Rotunda. How did she do it? It was a blind jury. I think there were 19 submissions. And they didn't know who the different authors or the different artists were, and so they picked the best one. When they found out who they had selected, that it was a young woman, there were many, many objections. It became a big issue. She was too young. She's only 18 years old. She's too female. She used women's wiles to get the the commission. How could she? It was a blind jury. They didn't know she was female. You know, in other words, obviously, when I say too female, the fact that she was female was, you know, obviously it shouldn't have had the commission. They said she didn't have sufficient training. Well, she was trained by Mills, you know, but she wasn't trained by someone in the Northeast United States, and she wasn't been trained in Europe. There were regional factions, and some of the people felt that it should be a Northeastern male sculptor who was chosen. And some of the Western senators felt like she was from the West. So this was something just wonderful for them. So they fought over it. Why was she chosen? Well, she did have an advantage. And it wasn't, was it William Wilde or not? She did have an advantage. They did feel that her image of Lincoln was authentic. That's just the word that was used. And the reason was because Ream was the only person who had actually modeled a bust of Lincoln, who had actually done a sculpture of Lincoln from life. She was trying to get her start in sculpture, and Lincoln heard about this poor girl who was starting out her career, and he turned down famous people who wanted to do his bust, but he gave her half-hour sittings daily for 5 months, and so she had worked from life on a bust of Abraham Lincoln, and you see her there with her bust. So she had actually seen Lincoln. She had actually worked with him from life, and of course this was shortly just before he was assassinated. So her work was considered to be very authentic and was considered to be the best likeness. She had to create the full-size life model, and like other sculptors, she took the model to Rome, where it was carved in Carrara marble. When she arrived, she became the darling of that American art community in Rome. You saw how pretty she was. She's pretty, she's vivacious. And one of the interesting tidbits that I found in one of my books was that William Story, the person who did the Cleopatra statue, he ridiculed Hosmer, but he admired Ream. And he's ridiculing Hosmer behind her back, and I don't come quite out and say it, but probably the point is that Ream is beautiful, and Hosmer is not. So this was also something, a woman could use her beauty, and I don't mean in a conniving way, but people do gravitate to beautiful people. You'll find, for example, more Hollywood actresses who are beautiful than those who are not. When you're promoting yourself, it doesn't hurt whether you're Vigée LeBrun or Vinnie Ream. Now, when the Lincoln statue was unveiled in the U.S., there was both criticism and praise. The criticism was because she hadn't really studied anatomy, and they said there's not a real sense of the body beneath the garments. The praise was that the image was very honest, it was very realistic, it was authentic. So here's Honest Abe with an honest portrayal. She was able to get commissions for busts for General John Sherman, General George Custer, and Horace Greeley. One of her works, which has survived and is fairly accessible because it's in the National Museum of American Art in Washington, D.C., is the statue of Sappho. And here, Sappho, who was known as the Tenth Muse, because she was a female poet, is shown as the Muse of Poetry. So you could read it either as the Muse of Poetry, or you could read as Sappho, who is personifying that. It is, as you can see, a neoclassical statue, very serene, very graceful. It is really a beautiful piece. And it's about life size, about 5'2" tall. There is a Greek inscription on the scroll that she holds, and it is, I'm not sure exactly, because the quote that I had a big part of the fragment, and I'm not sure how much of it is quoted, but I'm quoting from a translation of one of Sappho's poems. Sappho's poems are known only in fragments, so they number them. Dead you will be, and never memory of you will there be, nor desire into the afterlife. Which seems sad, very sad. And certainly we hope that both Sappho and Vinnie Ream continue to have a memory of them in the future. And I have some details here of the looking up at the figure, sort of looking just beautiful, graceful forms of the draperies falling, a slight contrapposto of the body, and then there was this beautiful curve of the draperies going across the body. And she has her lyre at her feet. And let's see, it really is an exquisitely beautiful picture. Another public monument that she received the commission for was the monument that is in the center of Farragut Square in Washington, D.C. This is David G. Farragut Memorial. In 1872, Congress authorized $20,000 to create this statue, and then it was dedicated in 1881. So you can see she got the commission when she was unmarried, and she was able to finish it, but we'll talk about what marriage did to her career shortly. Who is this? This is Admiral David Farragut, who was the first, according on the web it said it was the first U.S. Admiral and a Union naval officer during the Civil War. I found out he was born near Knoxville, so I thought that was interesting. He's known for the statement, "Damn the torpedoes, full speed ahead." Torpedoes being mines that were in Mobile Bay. Just very, very popular naval figure. In 1878, Vinnie Ream married Lieutenant Richard Hoxie. He was a lieutenant in the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers, and he rose to be a brigadier general. They lived in Farragut Square near her statue. And when she was married, she gave up sculpture because that's what her husband wanted her to do. She became a social leader, charity worker. She did what a well-bred wife should do. They had one son, Richard Ream Hoxie, and they also had a summer home in Iowa City, which it probably helped her to get another commission later on. Much later, around the turn of the century, she returned to sculpture. I found a statement in one of the books that said she was ill and then returned to sculpture, and I don't know, they didn't explain, was it that she was so ill and unhappy because she wasn't working that her husband let her do it, or was it just that now he was established and it was all right for her to go back to work as a sculptor? At any rate, she continued, she was still married, her husband outlived her, and she got some major commissions. The commission to do the statue of Samuel J. Kirkwood, who was an Iowa governor and senator, and the bronzes that would have been cast from her presumably plaster models are now in the U.S. Capitol in National Statuary Hall. She also received the commission to do the statue of Sequoia. Sequoia was the inventor of the Cherokee alphabet, and this is the first freestanding statue of a Native American to be displayed in the U.S. Capitol. It is, as we say, once again, it's in National Statuary Hall in the U.S. Capitol. This is the last work of Vinnie Ream Hoxie. She died in 1914, and so the work was completed by another sculptor, Zawane. Was completed by another sculptor, but presumably it was almost completed. One other thing I found was that she's buried in Arlington Cemetery, and on her grave there is a replica of her statue of Sappho.